The rainforest, home to countless species of animals and plants, food and income for millions of people, regulator of our global climate and water supply. Over the past decades, we have come to understand how we all depend on this place. And over that same period, we have done incredible damage to it. The global demand for commodities such as palm oil, paper and rubber has transformed huge swathes of jungle into vast monoculture plantations. Around half the world's tropical rainforests have now been cleared, leaving the remainder and all its shelters in critical danger. Responding to growing concerns from scientists, environmentalists and the public, a number of companies have now made commitments to stop tropical deforestation.
Well, in Unilever, we've made a commitment of zero deforestation by 2020, which means that some of our key ingredients will have to come from managed forestry, if that is the case, but ideally using degraded land, in my opinion.
For us to survive, we have to make sure that products that we're selling are no longer associated with any irresponsible practice, including deforestation. Nobody wants to buy products knowing that their products is causing natural forest destruction somewhere.
The new corporate forest commitments have brought former opponents from industry and environmental organizations together, working towards a united goal. But in order to turn their ambition into tangible change, a practical methodology had to be developed which factors in all complexities on the ground. This is now known as the high carbon stock approach.
The methodology that we came to is a combination of both ecological and social and some economic aspects. And the HCS methodology aims to identify the forest areas in the landscape so that they are protected and conserved, and identify the areas that are not forest and are available for potential development or for continued community use.
Identifying and classifying forest areas is easier said than done. Almost everywhere in the world, the landscapes in which tropical forests survive have become a patchwork of different types of land use. That's certainly the case here in Kalimantan, the Indonesian part of the island Borneo.
Here in Kalimantan, we see mostly logged over forest and a lot of community land use. And so the concession has been overlaid over the top of those previous uses or current uses. And in between that, we have different classes of forest or vegetations.
Creating a detailed map of that natural vegetation is a fundamental step in the process. The HCS methodology distinguishes six vegetation classes, or strata. These contain different levels of biodiversity and store varying amounts of carbon. Remote sensing data, such as satellite imagery, provides the basic information for the vegetation map. But interpretation of this data is complicated, and the initial vegetation map it generates is bound to contain a margin of error and uncertainty. In order to add further detail, teams of forest technicians are sent into the field. Here, sample sites are selected at random, but focus mainly on areas of young regenerating forest and low-density forest. These areas are potentially valuable for conservation, but can only be properly assessed through this ground truthing.
Jadi dari mulai pengukuran plot kecil, itu dengan diameter 5 sampai 20 cm, dan kemudian kita melakukan pengukuran plot di plot besar dengan diameter pohon 20 cm up. Gitu. Kemudian kita mengambil foto dokumentasi dengan 5 arah, itu fungsinya untuk mendapatkan gambaran tutupan lahan secara langsung, secara visual.
Combining the remote sensing data with the information from field plots results in a map showing the various patches of forest in the area. To determine which of these patches should be put forward for conservation, A decision tree founded on conservation science principles provides guidance.
So the decision tree works on the map that has been created, which tells us firstly where forest is. So it identifies each of the forest patches and tells us how big it is and what shape it is. So we can work out, using some absolute criteria, which ones we should really definitely conserve and which ones we can think about converting.
Larger patches will be prioritized for conservation, as they are likely to be more viable and contain more species. They are also less vulnerable to so-called edge effects. Forest edges are drier and prone to degradation, making them less suitable for animals and plants. Migration corridors and stepping stones allow movement of wildlife and transportation of plant species. This means well-connected patches will receive priority over isolated ones. Following such considerations through the decision tree, a map of proposed HCS forest is formed.
The advantage of having a decision tree is that you get exactly the same answer regardless of who's making the decision. Because it's very step by step, it's got very clear criteria at each of those steps, you will get different people looking at the same landscape who will make the same decisions. Now that's really important for a company which wants to be transparent about the process of expanding their plantations.
In the final steps of the decision tree, HCS patches are integrated with other areas that should be set aside for protection. These include high conservation value areas, which may, for example, contain rare species or unique habitat. Peatlands also need to be protected. Their deep soils contain huge amounts of carbon and are important to the global climate. Riparian zones, or riverbanks, need to be preserved because of their importance to water quality, biodiversity, and fisheries. As part of their conservation commitments, companies must restore and replant these areas where they have been deforested in the past. But ecological values and carbon content are not the only considerations in creating a land use plan. Any successful conservation effort begins by involving those who call the forest home.
There are two principal reasons why we have to work with forest peoples. The first reason is that they're very good at living with forests. They know much more about them than we do. If we don't involve them, then they've got to live anyway. So they're going to either be pushed aside and find somewhere else to live, which might be less sustainable, more destructive, or they'll actually be in open opposition to what's being imposed on them, and you get a whole lot of disputes.
When companies seek to expand their plantations while setting aside other areas for conservation, the rights of local people need to be respected. Central to this is the concept of free, prior, and informed consent.
So free, prior, and informed consent is a critical part of the high carbon stock approach, because you've got to have the community's agreement to what's being done on their land. They have areas where they make their living, where they hunt, where they fish, where they farm. Now a company comes in and they want to plant, say, palm or plantations of timber species. And then the high carbon stocks method is saying, yes, but some places can't be planted. They should be conserved in perpetuity. So the people have got to feel assured, yeah, but where are we going to make a living? What's in it for us?
In remote forest areas, formal documentation of land rights will often be lacking. This makes what is known as participatory mapping of vital importance. Through this process, communities can indicate sites that are of importance to their livelihoods and culture. Areas used for people's subsistence are to be set aside from any other considerations to ensure communities' food security. When all layers of the HCS process have been completed, a proposed integrated conservation and land use map can be formed. This map now needs to be agreed on between all key parties involved. Part of these negotiations is a give-and-take process, where some low- and medium-priority areas are exchanged, to increase the size and viability of larger patches.
Well, once you've got an agreement, of course, that's really only first base, because the next thing is to implement this whole land use plan. That requires working with the company and working with the community to make sure that things actually pan out in the way they've all agreed. One of the most important elements in this is that there are good incentives for the communities to abide by the agreements. Will they get jobs on the new estates? Will they get jobs looking after the conservation areas?
Social issues are certainly among the biggest challenges for the HCS process. In Indonesia, for example, a significant percentage of palm oil is produced by small-scale farmers who are not yet involved in the high carbon stock approach.
Target terbesar kami itu adalah kita mendapatkan tools-nya dulu. Sehingga ada pemahaman yang komprehensif untuk bisa mengimplementasikan HCS itu ke tingkat petani kelapa sawit. Kita mau menjadikan petani kelapa sawit itu sebagai aktor yang punya visi lingkungan dan juga punya visi sosial.
In order to succeed, both small-scale farmers and large producer companies will require government support at local, national and international levels.
After implementing this policy for almost 3 years, we came to realize that everybody needs to work together. The private sectors, NGOs, government, community. This is where we can synergize all our efforts together. For business sector, it's good for us, and for the government, it would be good for the government and for the country, because it helps us achieve as a country to reduce our greenhouse gas emission.
To ensure the involvement of key parties and keep the methodology credible, the HCS approach is overseen by a multi-stakeholder steering group and is advised by a committee of scientists. The steering group collaborates with other initiatives such as the HCV Resource Network and the Roundtable on Sustainable Palm Oil.
So one of the great opportunities we now have with the ACS approach is to implement it quickly. I think there is a need for urgency in its implementation. The second thing we really need to work on is to make these standards global. It is good to have it in one part of the world, and a lot of this has concentrated itself on countries like Malaysia or Indonesia, but we now also need to be sure that these standards are upheld in other parts of the world that are under threat, especially the Congo Basin and parts of Latin America.
The HCS methodology has now been tested successfully in a number of different countries and is starting to deliver results.
So far we have over 100 large companies who have made commitments to no deforestation and to using this methodology. There's hundreds of thousands of hectares of forest that have been identified for conservation and protection as a result of this. Now we'll need to work with all of the players in that landscape, in particular the communities who are the customary owners of those forests, to achieve the conservation. And then going forward, we'll need to keep monitoring these forest areas that have been identified for conservation. We'll need to ensure there is their restoration and conservation. We need new tools to ensure that we can really watch and monitor to ensure the forests are being conserved.
Time will tell whether the promise of no deforestation can truly be delivered on the ground. But with new technology and increased knowledge being added all the time, the HCS methodology provides the tools to turn that promise into practice.